In this video, we're going to be taking a look at an introduction to random variables. And probability distributions. We'll be focusing primarily on terms and definitions and vocabulary. There's going to be basically very little mathematics involved in this video. So first we want to talk a little bit about random variables. And since random variables typically result from a statistical experiment, we want to start by defining what do we mean when we say statistical experiment. So a statistical experiment is any process by which measurements are obtained. So this is not a particularly formal process. It's not the same as, you know, when you're talking about a designed experiment and you know, in designed experiments, there has to be a treatment group and potentially a control group and all that kind of stuff. When we're talking about statistical experiments, any process by which we obtain measurements can be construed as a statistical experiment. So this could be, you know, we roll a die 50 times and record the results. That's a statistical experiment. We go out and we measure the heights of a bunch of trees. That's a statistical experiment. Okay, any process by which measurements are obtained. And then statistical experiments frequently involve this notion of a random variable. So we also want to define that, as that's also part of the title of this video, Introduction to Random Variables. So what do we mean when we say random variables? A quantitative variable, which will usually be denoted by a lowercase letter x, is a random variable if the value that x takes on in a given experiment or observation is a chance or random outcome. Okay, it's a random variable if the value that x takes on in a given experiment or observation is a chance or random outcome. Now, key here, in order to be considered a random variable, the variable in question must be quantitative. Qualitative variables do not qualify as random variables. And the value has to be the result of a chance or random outcome. So you should be able to list the possible outcome values for x, like if we were going to roll a standard six-sided die. The possible outcomes are the numbers 1 through 6, but any individual outcome is the result of a random process. When I roll that die, I won't know in advance what the outcome is going to be. I'll know it has to be one of the numbers 1 through 6, but on any individual roll, I won't know what the result will be until I've actually performed the experiment. Okay, that's the idea with a random variable. Now, random variables come in essentially two distinct subtypes. One is a discrete random variable, one is a continuous random variable. So we'll talk about each one separately. So discrete and continuous. With a discrete random variable, can take on only a finite, or sometimes you hear that referred to as countable, number of values within an interval. Whereas a continuous random variable can take on an infinite number of values within an interval. And I'll give you some examples of each one. Those definitions of themselves are not particularly helpful until you get a sense of what it is that they're referring to. So with a discrete random variable, it can take on only a finite or countable number of values within a given interval. To give you an example, let's say we were considering adult male US shoe size. Okay. So within an interval, that means that usually there's a lowest value and a highest value to be considered. Let's say the lowest possible value for adult male shoes, it's usually a size 7 when you're talking about adults. Usually sizes lower than a 7 are boy shoes and not adult shoes. And let's say that the biggest size possible, I actually don't know what the biggest shoe size that they make for adult males is, but let's assume it's a size 17 for some reason. Okay, so let's say that this is the interval we're working with. Lowest possible value is a 7, highest possible value is a 17. Now, if we think about the kinds of shoes that we'll get within that interval, you can have a 7, a 7.5, an 8, an 8.5, and so on up to a 17. And we might reasonably ask ourselves, are there a finite or accountable number of values in this interval that shoe size can take on? In other words, could I count these and come up with a specific number? And yes, I could, right? 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5, 9, 9.5, all the way up to 17. I could quantify exactly how many options there are for shoe size within that given interval. The same is not true for a continuous random variable. So a continuous random variable might be, let's say, length of earthworms in centimeters. Okay, so let's say that that's my random variable that I'm interested in quantifying. And obviously the lowest possible value for the length of an earthworm, it has to be something just a little bit above zero. It could be really, really tiny, but something above zero, because if it doesn't have any length, it's clearly not an earthworm. And I have no idea what the longest earthworm ever recorded is, how long it is, but let's say that, I don't know, it was 45 centimeters long, something like that, okay? I'm sure there are some that are longer than that, but that's not the point of the exercise. Whatever the lowest is, and whatever the highest is, within that given interval, I ask myself, what kinds of sizes are possible for length of earthworm? And unlike the shoe size example, earthworms don't come in nice whole and half number increments in centimeters. It's not as though there's going to be one that's, you know, 0.5 centimeters, 1 centimeter, 1.5, 2, 2.5, right? I could have an earthworm that's 3.17085 centimeters if I wanted to be that specific about measuring the length. That is a possible value. I can have one that's exactly 2 centimeters long. I can have one that's, I don't know, 8.125 centimeters long, okay? Within that low to high interval, there is an infinite number of possible values within that interval that the length of an earthworm could take on, depending on how specific I wanted to be and how precise I wanted to be in that length measurement. The same is not true for shoe size, right? They come in whole and half numbers of values, and that's it. Length is a little bit different. So that's the difference between the discrete random variable and the continuous random variables. Now, the next thing that is covered in this section where we're talking about the intro to random variables and probability distributions is the notion of a probability distribution. Okay, what is a probability distribution and what does it do? So we'll take a look at that next. Specifically, we're going to be looking at probability distributions for discrete random variables. So a probability distribution is an assignment of probabilities to each distinct value of a discrete random variable. Or to each interval of values of a continuous random variable. So the idea with a probability distribution, it's related to the notion of sample spaces from chapter 4. Or from the probability chapter, where we list out all of the numbers of possible outcomes for the statistical experiment that we're doing, but then we have to pair each of those possible outcomes with its probability. So there will be a list of all of the possible outcomes, and then there will be a list of the probabilities of each of those possible outcomes. To give you an example, although it's a slightly boring example, let's say that we were dealing with rolling a six-sided die, and we wanted to create the probability distribution for doing that. So what are all of our possible outcomes? Well, they're the numbers 1 through 6. So those are the values of the discrete, in this case, random variable. Right? Between 1 and 6, there's a countable number of values that the variable can take on. So it's a discrete random variable. And here are all of those possible outcomes. So those are all listed under the X column. Then in a probability distribution, there will typically be a P of X column where you list the probabilities associated with each of those possible outcomes. So for P of X, the probability of rolling a 1 on a 6-sided die is a 1 in 6. A 2 on a 6-sided die is also a 1 in 6, and so on and so forth. Okay. So there is the probability distribution for rolling a 6-sided die. Similarly, if we were interested in looking at numbers of boys, if we have a family that has 3 children, for example, and we're interested in the number of boys that they have in that group of 3 children, the sample space there, again, a discrete random variable, we could have no boys in the group of 3, one boy, 2 boys, or all 3 could be boys. And then here, no boys is a 1 in 8 chance, 3 boys is also a 1 in 8 chance, and both of these two, 1 boy and 2 boys, are both 3 in 8 chances. Okay, so that would be the probability distribution for that. We've got the possible outcomes listed here, and each outcome has a probability attached. That's exactly what this whole probability distribution thing is all about. For each possible outcome of the random variable, we know in the table what the probability of the outcome is. And these can be expressed as fractions, they can be expressed as decimals, they can be expressed as percentages. If you do choose to leave them as fractions, they should be in lowest terms. There are a couple of key features of the probability distribution of a discrete random variable. Feature number 1. The probability distribution has a probability assigned to each distinct value of the random variable. And 2, the sum of all the assigned probabilities must be 1, or 100% if you've measured them in percentages. Okay. And when it says must be 1, this is exactly equal to 1. It can't be 0.999, it can't be 1.0004. It's got to be exactly 1. The sum of all the probabilities has to total to 100%. Now, if we look at these two examples here, we can see that they meet those features for being valid probability distributions. For each distinct value of the random variable, there is a probability assigned. We don't have any blank spaces over here, and we're not missing an outcome. You know, it's not like we didn't have a row for the outcome of 3 and 4. We've got all that information. We have all the outcomes listed. Each outcome has a probability attached. Same over here. All the outcomes are listed. Each outcome has a probability attached. That's that first feature. Second, if we add all of these together, it has to equal 1. So 1/6 plus 1/6 would be 2/6, 3/6, 4/6, 5/6, 6/6, which is 1. Or here, 1/8 and 3/8 would be 4/8, 3 more eighths would be 7/8, 1 more eighth would be 8/8, there's our 1. Okay, so sum has to be exactly 1. So both of those meet those criteria to be a probability distribution. There is one last concept covered in this section, and that is the notion of the mean and standard deviation for a discrete probability distribution. And the textbook does go over the formulas for computing these by hand, but I would rather show you how to do these on the calculator, but I'm going to upload that in a separate calculator video. So in addition to this video, you'll want to watch the video for how to compute the mean and standard deviation of a probability distribution using your calculator.